Ladies and gentlemen, jury, good morning.
Good morning. How
was your weekend?
Good.
Did we find something for you to do yesterday?
Yes.
Okay. How are the meals?
Good.
How are the accommodations?
Good.
Are the deputies treating you well?
Yes.
Good. It is not 10 o'clock, it's about 11:05. I want to apologize to you as I told you I had to qualify on the grand jury for the March term. So we qualified two different grand jurors this morning. One would meet Tuesday this week and one would meet Thursday this week. And we had to qualify that grand jury so the grand jury can continue its work. So it took a little longer than I would like it to take, but that's what the delay has been. It has nothing to do with this case, nothing to do with these lawyers. I had to talk to about 60 other possible jurors this morning to qualify 18 grand jurors for Tuesday that will go to work tomorrow morning, and 18 that will go to work on Thursday for the next 2 months through May 10th and I think May 12th. So appreciate your patience. I do apologize for the delay. When we stopped on Saturday, both sides had rested. I read all the law that could possibly apply in this case. You'll now hear closing arguments from both sides. And what I told you on Saturday, closing arguments are not evidence. The statements that are made by the lawyers are intended to help you in understanding the evidence that's presented. And again, we'll emphasize to you, somebody says something, because I can't comment on the facts. If somebody says something that you believe is not covered, something that was not presented, something that's not proof from the witness stand, you shall in fact disregard those statements, but I cannot tell you what I think may have been said. So you might have a lawyer that might object and say, just call if that's not what the record was, what the proof is. I can't tell you what I think. So if somebody says something that you believe is not supported, again, disregard it. You hear an argument from the state of Tennessee, and once the state has presented an argument, defense will be given an opportunity to present an argument also. And should the defense present an argument, you'll have a rebuttal argument from the state. So it's a possibility of three different arguments. State of Tennessee, you may proceed with your closing argument, Mr. Schofield.
So a couple problems with conspiracies. First one being, somebody always tells. The more people you involve with what you're doing, the greater that risk becomes.
So when you're having conversations in your kitchen in front of multiple people about killing your ex-husband, you're creating problems for yourself. And that's what Shara Wright did right from the get-go. She's already in this conspiracy, and she's already running the risk that somebody always tells. And here, someone did tell. Jimmy Martin, told in 2012, what his motivations were, who knows. Could be if you maybe promised to pay his legal fees and you don't end up paying them. Maybe somebody's holding a grudge against you and decides to talk. So that's a problem you got. And that's how we're here. Because this case was dead in the water. This was a cold case. They investigated in 2010, didn't charge anybody. 2012, Jimmy Martin comes forward and tells him what happened. He gets picked back up in 2016, and now the officers can go find evidence. They can go talk to other witnesses they maybe didn't know who they were before. They can find things to confirm Jimmy Martin's story. But that all comes from someone's always going to tell. Your number two problem with conspiracy. These are amateurs. We talked about this during openings and what here. They're written a 1-800 hitman hotline. So if you're Shara Wright, you decide to kill your husband, who are you going to get to help you? You can't just go down to Home Depot and ask around for murderers. So maybe you ask your cousin. He's kind of a shady dude, already has some legal problems. Maybe you're helping him out pay his bills. He may owe you. Who else do you ask? Friends, family, people from church. Maybe somebody you trust. Maybe somebody that's at your house all the time. Someone, per his statement, you've had sex with at least once. Someone you've had phone contact with 186 times during a 30-day period. That works out to about a little over six times a day. Who do you trust? Who are you going to get to help you? Your friend, baby, lover, Billy Turner. So, let's go through the elements real quick. First degree murder, clearly we got a murder. Lorenzo Wright killed, shot multiple times. Clearly that was intentional. Heard the proof from multiple people. Claudia, Jimmy, it's not dispute. This is planned out beforehand. Clearly there's premeditation. The elements for first degree murder, premeditated, have been met. Conspiracy, an agreement. We went over this a lot during voir dire. You have your jury instructions you can look over. They'll say something that probably looks a lot like this. An agreement to commit a crime, here a murder. Intent to do it. And then one party committed an overt act. But you know there was at least one overt act because he's dead. You have a lot of overt acts going, planning, getting things, setting things up, cleaning up, all that kind of stuff. But there's at least one overt act you absolutely know about. That's the murder. Course of conduct which terminates when the objectives of the conspiracy are completed. So it's not just when the murder happened, it's when the entire plan is done. Planning the murder, setting up the murder, committing the murder, cleaning up after the murder, hiding things, making sure nobody finds out. Just in this last part, specifically in your jury instructions, it will say concealing the crime. So when we're talking about a conspiracy, we've got any agreement between these folks, and anybody does an overt act up to and including the cover-up. And you've certainly heard from at least two witnesses about meetings to kill Lorenzo Wright where Billy Turner was present. We know the overt act is committed because he's dead. We'll go over some other overt acts that were committed as we walk through this. So the elements of conspiracy to commit first-degree murder have been met. Criminal attempt, first degree murder. You're going to do the murder, but you don't pull it off. You take a substantial step towards committing the murder of Lorenzo Wright. This is a charge for going to Atlanta when Billy and Jimmy went to Atlanta together. Getting in a car, getting guns, driving to a house, sneaking in a back window that sheriff probably left open for you, and walking around trying to find the person to kill, but he's not there. That is a substantial step towards the commission of the murder of Lorenzo Wright. It's a whole bunch of substantial steps. So the elements for criminal attempt first degree murder have been met. So we've met all the elements. All we're talking about now is who did it, what's their involvement. So you had Jimmy's testimony. It was long, went on a while. But the one thing you've had with Jimmy that's been consistent throughout all his meetings and talking to the police, all that, Billy Turner involved, sheriff's involved. There's a plot to kill Lorenzo Wright. There's a plot to do it in Atlanta. Gun thrown in the lake. Those things, he always says. Let's go through his testimony real quick. Sheriff Wright initiated a plan to kill Lorenzo Wright. Members of the conspiracy were him and Billy and Sheriff. They had at least one meeting at Sheriff's house where a pregnant lady was present. The police have no idea who this pregnant lady is when he's telling them about this in 2012. Lo and behold, we got a pregnant lady, Claudia Robinson. She told you. At various times, Sheriff provides guns and money for him to go to Atlanta and kill Lorenzo Wright. We've got them talking about guns and money on those Facebook messages. Jimmy fakes going to Atlanta and keeps whatever Sheriff provided. Now, that's interesting. Because that's the kind of guy Jimmy is. You're going to make a plan with him. You're going to give him money and guns. And he's like, okay, I'll do it. And then he sells the guns, keeps the money, and sits in Batesville and does whatever he's doing in Batesville. Not the most reliable guy. You've got Jimmy then has to go with Atlanta to Atlanta with Billy to kill Lorenzo Wright. He's got to go with Billy because Cher's not a complete idiot. If she sends him again to Atlanta by himself with money and guns, what's he going to do? He's going to keep the money and sell the guns and hang out in Batesville. So who else do you have? Who do you trust? Whose car are you giving Jimmy to do this sort of thing? Billy Turner. Because you can't send Jimmy by himself. You'll just get ripped off again. You got to send him with somebody you trust, somebody you're reliable, somebody you have a relationship with. Billy Turner.
More Jimmy testimony. Jimmy described the interior of Lorenzo Wright's residence in Atlanta.
You heard Michael Gibson testify. He had it down pretty good. He even described Mr. Gibson. Which the police, when they go find Mr. Gibson and talk to him, that all checks out.
Jimmy and Cher continue a message about guns and murder in crude code.
That may be the worst code I've ever seen. A party. We need a 9-inch monitor. I'm sure that didn't take y'all very long to figure out on your own glancing at it, much less when the attorneys went through it and when Jimmy Martin testified about it. But one thing you'll see that's consistent with Shara's method of communicating when she talks to her co-conspirators is she uses this weird, crude code, where I guess she's trying to maybe say, well, if somebody looks at it, no, we're talking about a party. You'll see that throughout this case when she's talking to Billy and when she's talking to Jimmy.
The night of the murder, Jimmy says he calls Billy from both his cell phone and his payphone.
We saw that borne out in the phone records. That's not really a dispute.
Sometime after the murder, Billy and Cher come get Billy's car. They come get a metal detector to help search the murder scene. Jimmy describes him searching for a lost gun with a metal detector and cutting barbed wire.
Well, you see in the crime scene pictures where a significant amount of that barbed wire has been cut out of that fence. So we know that happened.
Cher and Billy tell Jimmy how the murder happened.
We told you about that.
Susie's later picked up by Billy and taken to a lake to dispose of the murder weapon.
Well, lo and behold, we find this murder weapon in a lake. And it's the murder weapon per Sylvania Braswell. She tested it with shell casings with the bullets. All matches up. That's your murder weapon. Jimmy describes a shotgun being in the trunk of Billy's car. Come back to that in a minute. So, we've got what Jimmy's told you. We've got what Jimmy's told the police. This is the story. Now, they can't just walk off one person's statement and start arresting people. You have to do an investigation. You have to corroborate what's going on. How do you do that? They go find the pregnant lady.
Claudia. She says, Jimmy did attend a meeting
where they discussed killing Lorenzo Wright. Turns out that's true. Claudia Robinson, sometime babysitter, also a teacher.
She's going to tell you Jimmy was present at a plot.
They're talking about killing Lorenzo Wright. Jimmy described it as they were having a brainstorming session on how to do it. Billy Turner, also present at that meeting. Jimmy says he's there. Claudia says he's there. And never at any times during this meeting, we ask Claudia, does Billy get up and say, whoa, I'm trying to be done with a murderer. That's crazier. I don't want to be involved with that. Stays there. Doesn't walk away. Doesn't say, oh, I'm just the yard man. What are you doing? No. Stays at the meeting.
He's present when Cher, in fact, threatens to kill Claudia.
Doesn't walk out at that point. And it turns out there's a prior meeting where they're talking about killing Lorenzo Wright. That wasn't the first one. That was the second one. Jimmy's not even there.
The quote being,
Sharon saying, he's got a hit on me, he's got to go, it's either him or me, He's got to die. And Billy's response is like, not, no, that's crazy. Not, I'm getting out of here. Not like, whoa, lady, I just cut the grass around here. I don't know what you're talking about. This is nuts. Like, I'm going to the police. What are you talking about? It's, what do you want me to do, Sheriff? What do you want me to do? She says, he's got to go. That's the first meeting. The second meeting Jimmy's at, where they're threatening to kill Claudia and talking about having a brainstorming session on how to murder Lorenz and Wright. So now you got Billy at two meetings. Claudia says he's there. Jimmy says he's there.
And interestingly enough,
and you'll see in the pictures, there's not much of a yard there. And Billy's over at that house multiple days a week.
Let's move on to Facebook. Again,
you have, like Jimmy said, him and Cher discussing money and guns, using kind of this crude code where a party is the murder. Because Jimmy's a rapper, that's the kind of thing rappers do. They do shows, they do parties, they do performances. She kind of keys this off as some kind of job he's going to do for her. Right?
They use the word party instead of murder.
Jimmy's an aspiring rap artist.
This becomes more interesting when you start seeing messages Cher is sending to Billy.
Also, coincidence or not, I'm going to say not, she's couching this in terms of some sort of job he's supposed to be doing.
And I believe 11:47 at night, she's texting him, I'm going to need my commission. Ren want you to bring your cards in the AM before he fly out. You owe me, boy.
That doesn't make sense for several reasons. One, she's killing him that night. He will not be around to take any cards in the morning. She's sending this text to the person who is at least two meetings about killing Lorenz and Wright. Lorenz and Wright does not live in Memphis. How does that make sense?
In what world would
Lorenz and Wright passing out yard man cards in Atlanta make sense? And it was mentioned at some point, well, he could have been handing them out in Memphis. He doesn't live in Memphis. Cher lives in Memphis. If you need somebody in Memphis to pass out your business cards, that'd be Cher, not the guy who lives in Atlanta. That makes no sense. But if you're looking at it in Cher's crew code, just the way she texts people when she's trying to be sneaky, let's have a party, let's hand out your business cards, and this just so happens, 11:47, 25 minutes before the murder, she's sending that text. 25 minutes before Lorenz and Wright is murdered, she is sending that text. Not to Jimmy, to Billy.
Now, let's talk about some more communication. July 18th and 19th. Jimmy is in Batesville. Well,
I'll say the phone is in Batesville. Per the testimony of Detective Evans,
call at 1403, that's 2:03 in the afternoon.
Jimmy's calling Billy. Now, for two guys that have no relationship with each other, they aren't friends, they don't hang out, Jimmy doesn't do yard work with Billy, Billy doesn't rap. One lives down in Batesville, one's in Collierville. They sure are communicating a lot the day the murder's going to get done. And not around when the murder's get done.
This is 2:03 in the afternoon. Billy calls Jimmy back. 4:53. Billy calls him again. Jimmy calls Billy. 5:37. Jimmy calls Billy. 6:13.
Back and forth. Now, y'all heard all this testimony, and the defense is going to make out like this is some kind of way Jimmy's setting up an alibi. He's going to go do the murder and have someone call Billy for some reason. to establish that he's in basement using his phone and a payphone. How that makes sense when you don't have any relationship with Billy. If you're going to set up an alibi, you call your girlfriend or your mom so they can be like, oh yeah, that was him on the phone with me. That's who you call for the alibi. And here, you have that problem. That doesn't make sense. But the other problem is, at 11:43, Billy's calling Jimmy. Billy's calling Jimmy. Now, go back. Prior communication, 18:13, that's 5.5 hours later. 5.5 hours later. Take a glance at the phone records. Billy has, I think, 11 calls in between these two communications with other people while he's at this cookout, right? He calls Jimmy. Now, y'all heard Jimmy talking. He would have to be one heck of a criminal mastermind to make Billy call him for his alibi. I mean, that's unbelievable because it's unbelievable. Because this isn't some insane attempt at creating an alibi for yourself. Billy called Jimmy. Then Jimmy calls him back from the payphone, 12:01. Jimmy calls him back from the payphone, 12:02. Jimmy calls him from his cell phone right as the murder is happening. Jimmy's in Batesville. And the defense has to come up with something to say about that, because Jimmy's in Batesville, that's bad for Billy. If Jimmy's in Batesville, that's bad for Billy. Because who does that leave killing Lorenzen Wright, who was at the murder meeting? Billy Turner. And then we have a call at 12:14 that's important, not because Merle Hampton's calling, but as you've seen with the maps, that places Billy away from his home. That places his phone hitting a tower that's hitting over the same area as Lorenzen Wright's 911 call. Maybe Billy's a master, or Jimmy's a mastermind setting up this alibi phone calls. He's so good, he made Jimmy go have a call over the murder scene. That didn't make sense. What makes sense is Jimmy's in Batesville calling Billy back because Billy called him. You see the locations there. And as I talked about, and I know we have been over this so much with Sergeant Evans, but as you see, at 12:14, that call from Merwell Hampton. And again, these cones are representative. They do not delineate the actual length and width of the tower coverage. You heard Sergeant Evans say it is in fact longer, and is in fact wider, it could be as much as 0.5 mile longer. You see the overhanging coverage at the termination of that call. Termination of 911 call, when Merle Hampton calls, they're over the same area. And keep in mind, those three calls, the one from Jimmy's at 12:01, 12:02, 12:12, those are the ones Sergeant Evans said were on that tower near his house, but you couldn't say what side. And you couldn't say what side because it had gone down to analog. It's like when your phone goes from 5G to 4G or 4G to 3G because you're not getting a good signal. So we don't know what side of the tower he was hitting off when those calls came in. But I want you to think about what happens when you drop down to analog and your signal goes down. It's very possible his signal got worse because he was in the more rural area where they're killing Lorenzen Wright. And if you shade up the tower coverage from that home tower, that puts you right there, wouldn't it? Walnut Lake. Jimmy tells him where the gun is. That's where it is. Told him in 2012, for whatever reason, whoever was looking for it decided not to do a very good job. Seems like the FBI found it real quick. Murder weapons where Jimmy told you where it was. He describes a shotgun, and lo and behold, we find shotgun shells in the trunk of Billy Turner's car. The car hid out in the woods at his cousin's house.
And another interesting fact.
And I'm sorry, y'all. I'm going to try it one last time. And this is hard to see, but you should have this map in your packets. The lake for Walnut was described being out this direction, past Holly Springs, I think down 72. This is where Jimmy is. Jimmy, in his testimony, in fact, told you he threw some other gun in Arkabutla Lake. I hope I'm saying that right. Arkabutla Lake, which Mr. Perry, in his questioning, described as being a huge lake, a large lake. You also have another large lake, Lake Sardis, down here. Now, if Jimmy was going to pick the place to throw away a gun, don't you think he'd do it at Arkabutla, where he's already thrown one gun, and it's right off 55 as he's coming home? Or Sardis, which is right by his hometown. Now, Walnut, that lake, that's a straight shot over Collierville. That's what that is. Billy picked that lake. That'd make any kind of sense to skip two large lakes. One of one, you know Jimmy's already thrown a gun in because he told you he did. What makes sense is if you're in Collierville and you head out east, that's how you end up at Walnut. That's how you end up at Walnut.
And keep in mind, we haven't really talked about this a whole lot, but
if Jimmy's going to do this killing, wouldn't it make more sense for it to happen down in Mississippi, somewhere he's familiar?
We haven't really talked about how this is
right by Billy's house. There's no lack of rural area in Collierville to kill somebody, especially back in 2010 when things weren't as developed as they are now. We're going to get your cards to give Lorenzen, and then lo and behold, he gets killed over by Billy's house.
Mike Gibson, he testified.
He tells you about the details, the exact same details that Jimmy's telling you about going in the house.
No alarm system. He tells you Shara made an unexpected visit in June and told him she checked the place out.
That fits everything along with what Jimmy said. Because he and Billy did go to Atlanta to try and kill Lorenzen.
Then you have Billy's statement. Now,
keep in mind that the statement never got to the point where they did the formal written statement like they did back then. And while Billy's going to say some things that aren't too good for him in this statement, in this interview, when the defense gets up here and tries to tell you that the police made all this up, keep in mind that they also wrote down that he said he didn't do it. If that's the game we're playing, making up statements and putting them on Billy, the first thing in that statement would have been like, well, I'm not putting anything down on paper, but I did it.
First off, didn't do any business with Lorenzen Wright, only Sheriff.
Then why are we talking about giving Lorenzen Wright, who doesn't live here, your business cards? It's because he didn't do any business with Lorenzen. He wasn't giving Lorenzen his business cards. That's yet again Sheriff's crude code telling him it's time to do the murder over by your house in Callis Cutoff.
Didn't really know Jimmy, had only seen him twice, and they didn't have any dealings with each other.
Well, that's a lot of phone calls on the day of the murder for people you don't deal with, and you've only met twice. sexually involved with Shara. That's important. Because you're not just going to trust the guy who cuts your grass to get into a murder. But the guy's over at your house all the time, the guy you're having sex with, the guy you're talking to six times a day, that'd probably be somebody you trust.
He couldn't explain why his vehicle was at Shara's house the morning Lorenzen Wright was killed.
That should have been the easiest thing on earth. I'm there to cut the grass. There to plant some shrubs. And that should be instant.
Failed to point out Shara and Jimmy when shown photo lineups.
Shara, Jimmy. You could maybe understand Jimmy, but not Shara. Got visibly nervous when shown the murder weapon.
Said he met Shara at church when she suddenly came to town in 2017.
Well, that's not true. She even says in the message, you missed you at church. If you're having a completely innocent meeting with Shara Wright to talk about Snoop or whatever,
why are you going to tell that?
Because you know he didn't. You've seen the pictures. You've seen where Shara's yet again communicating with Billy in a crude code. This your sis from Cali. And the code's so dumb, he doesn't even know who it is. You can read those and see the response. And she had, and the other woman who's actually phoning this has to say, this is Shara on my phone. Now, why are you going through the third person's phone? She could have got her number. The woman had it. She could have got it and dialed in her own phone and called him. Why are you calling from a third-party phone? Or not even calling, texting this stupid code, this your sis from Cali. Why not be like, this is Shara. Are you coming to the cookout? Or dinner, whatever it was? No. Yet again, Shara using the crude code she uses when she talks to conspirators. Made it to get the metal detector from Jimmy's mom's house. Jimmy says they got the metal detector. Ellie's agreeing they got the metal detector. Gave some story about finding a diamond ring. But this fits in with what Jimmy's telling you. They got a metal detector to look for the 25 that was dropped. We know there's a 25 because there's 25 shell casings.
Admitting to going to Atlanta to visit relatives, but couldn't give the names or phone numbers of those relatives.
Phone numbers, okay. Even addresses, okay. But if you tell me you got relatives living in Atlanta, and I ask you who are they, and you say, Uncle Bob, Grandma, Cousin Jim, I was in Atlanta, but can't tell you who my relatives were there. I don't.
Okay. So it's a coincidence that he and Jimmy were there
at the same time. Well, now, I don't know what number of coincidence we're up to now. You're at both murder meetings. The last text before the murder from Shara is to you. Your phone's hitting over the murder site. We got shotgun shells in the trunk of your car. You're saying you're in Atlanta. You don't know the names of your relatives you're visiting. And if you're there at the same time as Jimmy, it's a coincidence. That sounds like somebody that went to Atlanta with Jimmy and is trying to explain how he didn't go to Atlanta with Jimmy.
You've got Lieutenant Beasley's testimony. They get a tip that Billy's cousin is all of a sudden trying to move this Dodge that's been sitting back there in the woods all these years. That's a bit strange.
to the point where he's dragged it out of there and flipped it upside down on a wrecker. He's trying to get it out of there so bad. Till a neighbor calls and tells on him. Same car they're using at the sign, same car he loaned Jimmy, same car they used to go to Atlanta, just like Jimmy said, in a Dodge. He identified the smashed up version of the car, said it looked the same. Red-handed wire cutters and shotgun shells in the trunk. Jimmy told you he had a shotgun in the trunk when they were throwing this stuff in the lake. We got 17 shotgun shells in that trunk. Another coincidence? Coincidence like being in Atlanta at the same time? Being over the murder scene? Being at the murder meetings? Getting the last text from Sharon, some kind of dumb code? Let's go back to the secret meeting. The new set of investigators are running this scheme. And it's a pretty good one. We're going to wiretap Shara and Billy's phone. We're going to release to the media that we found the murder weapon, and we're going to see what happens. We're going to see what happens. What happens? Shara gets on a plane, takes an unexpected flight from California to Memphis. She contacts Billy using a third party's phone. And we've been over this, but again, using that stupid code, this is your sis from Cali, come eat at TJ's. They meet at Janice Taylor's house, and we see them talk for 34 minutes. If you're catching up, talking about what everybody's been doing, who's been at church, how things going, how's the lawn business, how's California, how's the kids, what have you been up to? Isn't this great that they found the murder weapon so they're going to find the killers? You can have all that conversation inside the house with your other church friends. That's what you're there, Sunday afternoon, lunch, fellowship, socialization. That's what that entire dinner is for. But instead, you go outside and you walk up and down. Never talk. Talking after you've had this meeting arranged, the third party phone, using code. You didn't hand any proof about her going to see Jimmy. She went to see Billy. And the detective on the surveillance team told you they didn't observe her go to any other secret meetings. They were watching. They were listening on the phones. They're seeing what she's doing. She had one secret meeting. That was with Billy Turner. Because when they find the murder weapon, you got to go talk to the person who used it to make sure he isn't the one telling police stuff. Because somebody always talks. Somebody always talks. And when you find a murder weapon, all of a sudden it's been missing for 7 years. Somebody's talking. So let's go over what we found out about Billy Turner, independent of what Jimmy told you. He has a sexual relationship with Sarah. They have 186 calls in a 1 month period. He's present at her house multiple days a week. He's present at the first meeting where Sharon says she wants to kill Renz and Wright. His reaction is, what do you want me to do? He's present at the second meeting about killing the Renz and Wright when Claudia is threatened. He calls Jimmy right before the murder. Right before Shara sends in this coded text. He's the last person she contacts. His cell phone connects over the same area as Lorenzen Wright's 911 call. You heard Sergeant Evans tell you that has to mean he left his house. It's too far. So he's left his house, and he's over the same site. The murder occurs near his house, but not on the same tower, as you heard the sergeant tell you. Shara erases all her texts. Not just Jimmy's texts, all Billy's texts. Now, they recovered some of them, because we've seen them. But they said in the corners, you can see where that little red X is. Those are the ones she's erased. Strange to take the trouble to erase a text if it's just about business cards. But if it's about a murder, you're going to erase that one. He admits to going to Atlanta, but can't tell you any relatives he visited or who they even are.
Again, Paul using the third party. Crude code. Lies about the nature of his meeting with her.
He was part of this conspiracy to kill Lorenzen Wright. He's at both meetings. He never says he doesn't want to be a part of this. He never says, I'm not doing this. He in fact says, what do you need me to do? So you know he's in on the agreement. You know he's in on the plan. You know there's been an overt act because Lorenzen Wright's dead. But we've had other overt acts. Going to Atlanta, it's an overt act. Picking up the metal detector. Picking up the metal detector's an overt act. Going back to the crime scene, cleaning up, it's an overt act. Cutting out barbed wire is an overt act. Throwing the gun in the lake is an overt act. Take your pick. He's there at the meetings. Ask what needs to be done. He's part of the agreement. He's part of the plan. There's an overt act. He is guilty of conspiracy to commit murder. He went to Atlanta to try and murder Lorenzen Wright. There's no way Shara is going to trust Jimmy with a car and money and guns after the first time she did it, he ripped her off for his own admission. He said he conned her. So when you've got a second trip to Atlanta, and you know Jimmy went because he describes the interior of that apartment, she is not going to send him by himself to steal all her stuff again. And you combine that with Billy saying he's in Atlanta, he can't tell you who he was there to visit, it's just a coincidence if he's there at the same time as Jimmy. That doesn't make sense. Because he was there with Jimmy. And going to Atlanta and going to that house with guns. That's an act towards the completion of that crime. That is criminal attempt murder. He is guilty of criminal attempt murder. Covered it up from start to finish. We got cleanup. We got throwing away guns. Little details, like Jimmy mentioned in the shotgun in his trunk and finding shell casings in his trunk. Those are little details I want you to think about and put this all together. What do you want me to do, Shara? What do you want me to do? I'm still shaking. Shooting around. I'm still shaking. I'm shooting red. That's what Jimmy said he said. Those are the two statements you need to keep in mind when you're thinking about who murdered Lorenzen Wright. Whose phone's over the site? Billy Turner. Who's the last text with Shara? Billy Turner. Who said, what do you need me to do? Billy Turner. Who's the person who murdered Lorenzen Wright, pulled that trigger while Jimmy's in Batesville? Billy Turner. After you review all this proof, I expect you to find him guilty on all charges. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, before the defense presents the closing argument, does anyone need a break? Ms. Perry, you may proceed.
No, no, over here, my brother's production.
All right.
Yes, sir. Proverbs 18:17 says, the story of a witness is true when he first gets to the stand until confronted for cross-examination. And ironically, the center or the heart of the walnut on this particular case is found in 17 and 18 of your jury charges. 17 and 18 of the jury charges talks about the credibility of a witness. And the fact that when you cross-examine a witness, you have to consider what they're saying during that time. In other words, if the witness statement that is given at one day back in May of 2012 after you signed a contract with the state of Tennessee changes, alters, is broken apart, or in the case of Jimmy Martin is decimated while he sits there, then you can't really give him much credit. Now, in this instance, Mr. Schofield, had he been Jimmy Martin, I guess would be pretty precise, and then my commentary at this point would be pretty much worthless, because as Mr. Schofield says, it's just a cut and dry case, and you shouldn't consider the fact of number one, the person who is delivering the message, number two, the witnesses that you've heard. You've heard from starting at the top, you heard from the mother. The mother indicated that her son was somebody who was drafted number one back in, I think, in the 1996-1997 draft. He was in the first round, number seven draft pick. And her son, prior to that, had spent a life of accomplishment, of athletic achievement. He also, in order to get to that point, had to have academic success. So you're talking about somebody who lived a life that is worth celebrating, a life that is the center of that family, I'm assuming, because that's the person that everybody says, hey, he's this, he's that, he's this, you know. And if you notice, when she testified, I asked one question regarding the date that was when he was supposed to be coming in town to go to his sister's baby shower. That date is important because even though the state accepts this premise, hook, line, and sinker, that the trip was in June or in some date that you can't find based on tower records, etc., of 2010. If you look at the commentary, if you look at the evidence, not at Jimmy Martin, who knows how to trick cell phones and how to have somebody calling from another location, if you look at the evidence, the stuff that we had to ask to get in, not just one part of an evidence, not just a cut and slice, but look at all of it. You 12 individuals will go back and have the ability to look at not only the messages from Edna J. on the night of July 15th, which I am absolutely convinced he's in Atlanta meeting with Shara. It's only common sense. K, same place. 8:15, cool. 8:30, he's a little bit behind. 8:50, been here for 40 minutes. What you in? Van. All right. Now, whose car does he have? Whose car does Jimmy Martin say that he has during that time frame? He has Billy Ray Turner's car. Why does he have Billy Ray Turner's car? If they are supposed to be acting in concert, why does Shara need to ask Billy Ray to loan little Jimmy his car? It makes no sense. Why does he tell you all, not the state, not anybody else, until he says it? And you know when he said it? He said it on cross-examination, but he also said it a little bit before cross. Hopefully, I guess he was being more honest than normal, but he said it himself, even though nobody in the state's case in chief said it. Nobody mentions it. That he had a partner with him working during this time. And I asked him on cross-exam, because I've been waiting some 1,107 days to ask him,
You had a partner with you during all this time, didn't you?
Yes, sir.
Because prior to that, on direct, he said it. Oh, that text message, it was off because my partner that's texting it said it. Now, he was clear. That ain't Billy. That's some partner. I don't care. It's not my job to solve the crime of the century. It's not my job to step in the stead of the Memphis Police Department, who, when Jimmy comes to them, for whatever reason, prior to being sentenced for whatever crime back in 2012, they didn't delve into the actual nuances of the case. They didn't ask him those questions. They didn't ask him about what partner he's talking about. They listened to some crazy contrived case or the story about him telling them verbatim that this man is jumping through the woods like a deer, that he got shot at this point, that at this point we were running this way, and he also, if you notice, would mix his pronouns up. We, I, they, you don't know where he was, but if you look at those Merle Hampton text messages, it'll become clear that he's absolutely, positively in Memphis at that time. It'll become clear on the night that he got killed that person, Jimmy Martin, was not only the person who was there, who was working on setting it up, who didn't tell police back in 2012 that he had ever been in Lorenz's apartment, but this week described it perfectly, in 2017 described it perfectly, and then he says it step by step, an additional step along the way, that yeah, I did go inside. And then finally, when he testified, I went inside, pistol drawn, and I was with Billy. But if you notice, how did Billy get there? He says he took Billy's car at Shara's request from Shara's home to Batesville, Mississippi. He also said that he went from there and took some guns that Shara supposedly gave him, that if you recall, and I ask because it is an important fact. Now, Claudia and Jimmy have been given these different agreements, and they all say the same, well, yeah, it was a couple of meetings, and yeah, Billy might have been there, but they all said, they both said the same things on this. Billy never agreed to do half of anybody. Now, that's important. I don't care what you say or you know, or how well it draws for this, for the purposes of a PowerPoint presentation. They both said Billy Turner did not agree to do anything. Now, it's confusing somewhat on whether or not Billy was there and heard some round table meeting, because if you listen to Jimmy, she never saw a meeting with any guns. If you listen to Jimmy, Billy wasn't there at the meeting involving any guns. I don't remember him being there. That's the center meeting, according to Jimmy, that Shara gave him the guns to go and trade and get a 9mm and a 25. Ironically, the caliber of the spent shell casings that are out there on that scene. But according to them, Billy wasn't even at that meeting. Now, you'll hear a lot of conversation different ways, and when you all go back there, y'all are going to discuss your various notes. Look at the cell phone records from Billy Turner on the days that are leading up. When he gives his car some weeks earlier, all of a sudden Jimmy does call him sometimes. Are those operational calls regarding this older car that Billy has loaned him? Billy's got his own way in the world. He's got his own business. He's got his own truck. He's also got a motorcycle. He's got his own place to live, his own girlfriend. The stuff about Billy and Shara having sex, if the officer was being candid with you, he said that was years ago. But he kept his relationship as far as trying to help her, like he would do anybody else in that church or in that community if they asked him. Let me be clear. Shara Wright came to Billy with a request to allow her cousin to use his car. He didn't give the keys to Jimmy. He didn't sit up and come up with some concept on what they were going to do together against Lorenzen. How many times have you been in a car with somebody 18 hours and you've never had a conversation about anything with them? That's law enforcement asking him about it. That's John Perry asking him about it and saying, Y'all talk about anything. Y'all didn't talk about sports. Y'all didn't talk about the world. Y'all didn't talk about Cheryl. Y'all didn't talk about anything during this 18-hour trip. Where you drive to Atlanta, it's too early to try to go into the home. Y'all go to IHOP. Y'all don't go inside IHOP. And why are these points important? Because everywhere that you can try to say that this person can be seen on a camera, he doesn't try to validate it. But wherever you can tell that his car has been at a location, because he knows this, and if you listen to what he's saying, he's sitting there driving this man's car. He knows about tracking devices. He knows about the fact that if you pass certain areas, that the license plate tags or whatever will be there. So he's not stupid. He's not saying, yeah, I went down to Atlanta 3 days before, but y'all ain't stupid either. You can read the information as it's there. Now I'm going to jump a little bit and I'm going to come back. Now, you have all of these different messages. You got Facebook. The Facebook messages, the only reason he was so nice about explaining those and, oh yeah, that was our secret message, etc. He never told the police about those messages, ever. He didn't tell them until Billy Turner was in a jail cell for three months. He told them because they confronted him with getting the Facebook record. But you don't have those Facebook records from Billy. You got those Facebook records from Jimmy. This is in a code. Cheryl talking to Ren on days prior to him coming to Memphis is crystal clear that she's in Atlanta. You got a chance to read the whole thing. They got a daughter down in Atlanta that's doing a modeling show. And she's down there talking to him about that stuff while she's in Atlanta and while her cousin, little Jimmy, is rendezvousing with her. Ain't nobody talking about some stuff happened in June. And ain't nobody, how in the world is a window open in June, you're gonna have the confidence to do it in July? That doesn't make any sense. He's down there during that same week. And if you look at the records, when he's talking about where are you, and why is she talking about meeting at a location, same place as before, and why is it that you can't pinpoint what time you're going to arrive unless you're arriving at a place like Atlanta to do whatever you're trying to do? It doesn't make sense. But these are codes that are in messages. I mean, in messages that are in codes, when you're talking about Edna J. I know you're tired of me and my party, but what's up? You good? Everybody straight. That's from Jimmy to Shara. When Shara has been using Billy's car to allow her little cousin to drive, in Billy's mind, to legitimate locations, what does she tell him I want to do for you? You know, Lorenzo Wright is not just some basketball playing guy, what have you. He's a guy who in this area was a star. At Booker Washington, he was a star. University of Memphis, he was a star. And then he's a pro athlete for the Grizzlies in this area. Do you think that he's out passing cards to people on some corner about doing it? Or do you think that Sheriff is going to explain to Billy, man, he knows all kind of bankers that have buildings. He knows all kind of folks that have, he knows the president of FedEx. He knows the president of this location. He can get you on with all kind of folks. You help me out like this. And then the setup call, why in the hell, if all the other calls are in code, is her code to Billy directly mentioning Ren? Because she's trying to put him in the situation. If something goes wrong, and let me also say this. From everything that I've read in our discovery and the stuff that I know and have tried to learn about Ren, he wasn't stupid. He wasn't going to go out on the road to meet Billy at midnight. What does it make sense to do that? Why wouldn't you tell Billy the conversation between Shara and Ren being Jimmy got that dude's car and he broke down over off Callis Creek? Come on, let's go over there. They walk up on him. That's common sense. They walk up on him, and when they walk up on him, this punk comes up blasting. This ass trickster, as he calls it, shot him. and then ran him down and shot him again, probably with the same partner that he could describe that's texting her weeks earlier about, we can't do it now, inside, outside. You don't have any inside, outside call from or text messages from Billy to Cheryl. Those are all text messages from Jimmy, Jimmy's friend who's going down the highway, and Cheryl, not Billy and Cheryl. There's nothing from Billy and Cheryl other than at midnight they're talking about some weird stuff. And people know in this inner circle of Cheryl how Cheryl is. You heard her own cousin. The cousin who supposedly knows about a murder plot, supposedly is scared, but is stunting at the party at the funeral in front of this guy's mama as a clout chaser. She's around walking around and you can't keep her out the camera. Oh, come on, baby. I got you. I'm going to walk the child to the bathroom back and forth because I'm the nanny, the pregnant nanny. And that makes sense to you? Come on now. This is a simple issue. What has happened here is they gave a contract to this guy before they had an opportunity to vet his story. They let him sign a document saying, no matter what you tell us, if it checks out or not, you're helping us solve this case. Because you're helping us solve it, you will have a get out of jail free card involved in it. They know that he has said that he used the guy who's the landscaper's car. The media builds a story up about, well, this is a lawn man. And as if Shara has some really, I guess, elaborate estate that he lives in the basement on and comes up, Miss Shara, can I cut your yard today? Do you need me to get your stuff out your pool house? And all that. No, that's not it. This man has his own business in the area that he grew up in. And he cuts her yard and he cuts other yards on that street, he cuts other yards on that block, and he's respected. And they want to try to make him out to be what he ain't, somebody to manipulate. If you look through the rest of his messages, there's no manipulation between Cheryl and Billy, other than the fact that he was nice enough to loan the car keys to his vehicle, an old roustabout vehicle, and let her cousin use it to go back and forth, supposedly for legitimate work, to go DJ or whatever it is that he wants to do during that time frame. But why, if I'm involved in some conspiracy to kill her husband, am I going to put my car in it? That doesn't make any sense. I'm going to give you my car keys and allow you to come up with a conspiracy involving me. I'm going to talk about this conspiracy in front of cousins that I don't know as well, other than what Claudia said. He was nice, he was prayerful around the house, and he would come over some. Now, if you take it with Claudia's words, they radioed her up. Everything that can be documented to be brought in court, you hadn't heard any. How are you going to have recordings where she is supposed to talk about Billy, hopefully? I'm assuming that that's why the police would mic her up. And you don't have anything at all that's bad from either Cheryl and Claudia about Billy, or from Claudia to any other third person about Billy. You don't have any of that. You just have word of mouth about what supposedly Billy and Cheryl told this guy in the days after regarding a murder. Now, another central point. Why you're trying to, if you're going to be involved in this, to the sense that you're trying to gather information to blackmail somebody, why are they going to Batesville to recruit you to do this crime repeatedly, according to his testimony? Why would you just not say anything? What would be the purpose of the blackmail? Why do you have an expectation that she's going to continue to pay stuff for you, and it's based and predicated on the fact that you're going to commit this murder? How does that make any sense? Yeah, Billy, they went through his finance records, they went through his bank accounts, they went through everything. There's no mention of any sort of money that he was supposed to be. And when confronted by Mr. Thomas about that fact, he's going to say, well, he's paid in other ways. But he never said what the other ways were. That was supposed to be that he's so enchanted with her that he's going to commit a murder. Now, the thing about being enchanted or sprung or over the top about a female, you might kill somebody that you think that she's interested in or you think that he's disrespecting you. That's not going to lure you into some crazy contrived murder plot. That's going to be somebody who thinks that they're going to get their legal fees paid, that thinks that they're going to get ahead because they don't have a job. Somebody that does not have a job that's coming up from Batesville to Collierville, putting themselves in the middle of this murder plot over and over. Come on, y'all. Why would they have to go after Billy? Why would the state of Tennessee put Billy in front of you all for this week to try to resolve this? Because the state of Tennessee is smart enough to know that they wrote a contract with a guy like Jimmy. And if you write a contract with a guy like Jimmy who has all the details of all the stuff that was supposed to be involved, how do you solve the murder of this son of Memphis? How do you solve it? You know, I've been involved in this now since 2017, and I've come to know Billy, and I know he's a stranger to y'all, and I know y'all are gonna have some stuff you go back and forth on. Some of you are gonna have your minds already made up one way or the other. I can't do anything to change that at this point other than to tell you what I really believe. I know that the information that I've gathered thus far is just like what came through Ms. Bogan. He's a salt of the earth type of guy. He just is. He gave his car to somebody. You don't have any kind of coded messages between he and this person's wife or ex-wife or mother of his children. You just don't have that with him. You have Billy going about life trying to work all day long with the hardest type of work that you can have out in the middle of the day in July, back-breaking work, trying to build his own life. And you'll have the photos of him walking with Shara at Shara's request, because Shara knows Billy ain't a fool. After Lorenzen goes missing and after Lorenzen's body is found in a field, he ain't dumb enough to think that all of this talk that y'all have regarding my car and stuff like that, all of this crazy stuff according to Jimmy, he's calling Billy on the night before, the day before the murder, and he doesn't have good coverage out there during that time, and he tries to call it back. And Jimmy says something about, I'm trying to get Shara's van. He ain't dumb. He realizes at that point, yeah, my car has been involved in something that I don't want it to be involved in. And yeah, did he cut Shara out of his life? Yes. She couldn't get in touch with him. And did she have to get a third party? Why did she have to use a third party? Because Billy did not have Shara's numbers. He didn't have anything about her in his life, because that caused an issue in his life. That's not him trying to, that's not somebody over the top in love. Look at those photos. Those photos were taken back in 2017, where they're outside of the house walking, and this person that he's supposed to be over the top in love with, he's social distancing more than folks social distanced last year. He's not walking hands in hands with this lady. That truck, that ain't somebody destitute who's living off of Shara. That's something that he's worked for, hard, back-breaking work for, that he thought that all of a sudden her dealing with her cousin has caused him issues. This, walking around out here, you think if Shara, who's Googling, who's wondering what's going on, what are they, you know, what is the deal with the gun found in the water, you think that she is not telling him, look,
Shape to this speculation that hasn't been testified about at all?
Oh, all of this is speculation.
Ladies and gentlemen, lawyers can argue three things. They can argue the facts of the case, they can argue the law, and they can argue reasonable deductions from what you heard in court. And again, if a lawyer says something that's not supported by the record, you will in fact disregard it. You may proceed, Ms. Perry.
Thank you. There's no way that you can try to come up with
with the notion that is supposed to be favorable to the prosecution about what they're talking about outside. You don't know what they're talking about, but I know one thing. It ain't about Billy having done nothing to kill Mr. Wright, because it's not supported by anything. The only person that has all these details is Jimmy Martin. And so, in this situation where you give an absolute guarantee to a person, to the first, regarding we're not going to in any way prosecute you, and he gives multiple stories about what was supposed to happen, when they find out that in fact his car, Billy's car, was outside, and that's one of the PowerPoints, interesting enough, he says, well, you can't explain why, he couldn't explain why his car was outside that night. And you have Jimmy saying, I had his car on the night that he got killed. That's not rocket science. Of course he had his car on the night that he got killed. He killed him. That's silly. But you got a major star, and you got a guy that has a lawn service. When I first got involved, there was one day I got a question from a media person about, why would you take this? Why are you involved? I'd be a little put off, but it was a unique question, and I think I got the answer. In looking at it, like I was saying earlier, Lorenzen and the friend and fraternity brother that came in here that described the fact that he had been on the couch in that apartment, but didn't see my guy in that apartment, but that he had been in that apartment and described the layout of the apartment, same way that Jimmy, who had been in there, has described, you know, misses his friend, and I understand and respect that. The city of Memphis misses a person who went off to the big life and came back and gave back some. There's no doubt about any of that. But here, just like Lorenzen is important to his family and friends, Billy Ray Turner is important to his. And you have, in this instance, a person who, if you take the credibility of that person and bolster it in behalf of what the state is saying, then I guess you'll get to the point that the state is saying is right. But I believe that if you take it and you shake it a little bit and look at the credibility of the way that he answered questions, that it was purely illogical. But more importantly, he repeatedly lied. He talks about the fact that he saw a 2-foot-long bolt cutters, and they showed you a picture of basically some handheld cutters that they're going to try to say cut barbed wire that was dense. And that when they sent it out to the crime lab, you don't have a report saying this, in fact, is the bolt cutters that cut this wire. It just doesn't make sense. Radio splicing cutters, they're not the same as bolt cutters. But Jimmy Martin cut those bolts and threw them in some water somewhere. But when you measure Billy Ray Turner and Lorenzen Wright, of course, Lorenzen Wright, being a 7-footer that was talented, that went out into the world and did what he was supposed to do, seemingly is more important. He's worth it. He's worth the fact that this person has to come in and face these charges, because we've given a get-out-of-jail-free card to another person. And then you have Claudia. Claudia came in and testified. Did her testimony really damage Billy at all? I didn't think so. Other than the fact that she got put off by my questions towards her, was it making any sense? Did it make any sense if she says that Billy's response to Cheryl was the same as hers? What you want me to do about it, Cheryl? I'll fix it, go out here, finish edging, and go down the street. That's what that testimony was. It wasn't, yeah, we do need to, you know, what we're going to do? How are we going to do it? It was Jimmy who was saying what he could do and how he was going to do. And Billy not being there whenever the guns were banning about, how do you add that up? What the hope is here, that you all, in consideration of who it is,
we're going to make a determination saying that Billy's life is worth it. It's worth of finding him guilty of something where the state fails. It's worth it to find him guilty when the state can't meet the burden of proof beyond a reasonable doubt. When I first took it, only thing Billy wants is this day. Billy wants this day, that before you all, he would have a chance to get his name back. You got a guy who has a horrible, horrible demeanor. You see that he has all the incentive in the world. He's angry at his cousin. And he just simply takes Billy's name and inserts it where his belongs. Did Jimmy Martin get you past proven not guilty is hard? We got a video out there on that site. We could possibly prove him not guilty. I know they presented Sergeant Evans, and Sergeant Evans' testimony was, when no matter how they argue it, they argue with the I'll get louder approach, and I'll take my broom handle and point it and say that this has to be where it is, but their own sector person could not say definitively that he's out there on that field on that particular night. He said that he lived in a way, in a place, and if you notice, when he's testifying without being cross-examined, he's saying stuff like, oh yeah, this is when Billy's in, and it's going to be in the pamphlet that you all look at. This is when Billy's at Sheriff's house. But you heard from Miss Bogan, then no, that evening he was at my house. And if we're going to try to bolster or lie about it or try to create an alibi, that's not what we're going to do when we create a gap ourselves. What we wanted to show is his demeanor. You look at him and you see and say and make your decision on whether or not this guy eating ice cream and cake with his church folks is in a few hours going to sit up and meet this guy on a dark road and kill him. Has anybody gotten you past unlikely? Has anybody gotten you past maybe not? Has anybody gotten you past perhaps? Perhaps Billy did it because he loaned his car for a couple of weeks. Perhaps he wanted to facilitate a murder without there being any conversation from the testimony from the witness stand saying that he agreed that he wanted this man killed. So when you're in voir dire and they're asking all of these different questions about, well, if this person involved in a bank robbery and this person says this and this person says that, and somebody poses the question, well, what did he know? That's where we're at right now. What could he possibly have known if he's not part of any kind of coded language and he's not getting involved with that code with Shara or me? Have any of them got past suspecting that Billy did? Now, you have Frias. Frias is the goal to get you right here. That he gets you, he gets Jimmy, in, I mean Billy in, he arrests him, he talks to him, he says that other than the first 48, nobody is recorded in 2017. I haven't seen that policy. I'm not going to call a man a liar. I got too much respect for him, but I haven't seen that policy. I know that if that was going to be a policy, that instead of him acting like this, he's moving around in that chair more than Jimmy was. I know that if I'm going to establish that, why I didn't record him, I'm going to have that policy. He says his heart beating out of his chest. My heart be beating out of my chest too. You asking me after you arrested me while I'm at a gas station and pumped my gas and got my Gatorade and thinking I'm going home for the day, and you arrested me on some stuff that Shara and Jimmy did, more likely than not, in my car. Yeah, I'm going to be heartbeat. Well, he tells me that he has had sex with Shara before. He's trying to be candid with the man. But he's wanting all the time. Ain't no recorder, no video in here. I'm just in some room with this guy that I don't know. You think my heart's not going to be beating a little bit? He's trying to be candid with him. Somebody that he just said he had sex with, you put a picture of her in front of you. And if he's squinting while he's looking at it and he can't tell, does that mean that he is trying to deny it? He told him he knew both of them, Jimmy and Shara. That doesn't mean that he's trying to evade his question. Because he probably can't tell if he ain't seen him in 5 years or whatever. He saw a sheriff a few days earlier. But from the photos that he had, they didn't show us what photos he was supposed to be looking at. But with the photos, if he can't tell who it is, that's not lying to him. Now, have you gone to Atlanta? Tell me about your trip to Atlanta. That's how you ask him. You ask somebody that question? Yeah, I've been to Atlanta with family and friends. Tell me what family and friends you've been to Atlanta with. Man, I'm through. We're not on equal ground here. I'm through talking. Let's end this. I'm not some idiot. I'm through talking. I take my chances. Just call me out in court. Hey, this is arraignment day. You want your own lawyer? I don't want nobody pointing. I'll get my lawyer. I got my own in this world. I vote the way I want. I think the way that I want. I'm a man. And I'll take my chances with you all. And so when I'm asked that question from the media, what would he want with this? Why would he want a trial? He wants a trial because he's a man with a name. He said, what's a name? No, Lorenzo's got a name. Internationally known basketball player. He's a good guy. Billy's got a name. Not internationally known, but locally known. Good guy. Good guy. Name is everything. A name is everything. A name is everything. No matter how humble the beginning is, your name is your everything. When I grew up, I went to a church not too far from here, off of Kansas. And at a point around the fifth, sixth grade, I was reading about a guy named A. Philip Randolph. A. Philip Randolph was the guy over the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters. A sleeping car porter is a guy back in the day that would be responsible for doing the servant duties on the trains. And he would have the ability to start off his day in Memphis and go from here to St. Louis, Minneapolis, or Chicago. And when I was doing the reporter, I was talking with my grandma about it, and she said, sleeping car porter that went to this church years ago. By the time it passed, and her friends, Willella, she went to Willella the next time we called Miss Willella, and said, can you tell them about Walt and sleeping car porters? He's doing a report. So, of course, she suffered me and my questioning. And at the end of it, said, well, you want to be a girl? I want to be a lawyer. Like I said, I got two sons that are lawyers. Wow. So we went on, and it was a good conversation, and I put the stuff that she said in the report. But as time would have it, I discovered different things about those two boys. Discovered that one of the boys would go off and be a big-time city council member out in the West Coast and move back to Memphis and give back. He was president of his school when he was in school and all these good things. And one son was a good football player and went out as All-American. Went to school, got his law degree, and came back and put into his community. Time would tell that these lawyers would go on to other things. One would argue in front of the Supreme Court today that's known across this United States of America. Other son would be eulogized by a president of the United States of America. That's a name. More importantly than that, when a person goes to file something and says, well, I got rear-ended by a car or what have you, you go to a building that's named after that across the street. This week, while you sit listening in judgment of Billy Ray Turner, you sit in a building named after that man. The only demarcation that's different is that it's Walter Bailey Jr. and not Walter Bailey Sr. That man worked every day as somebody who, when the bed sheets were messed up, they would call him, Porter, come here. When somebody was out of their drink, Porter, pour a drink. Every day, sometimes listening to different indignities, sometimes going into cities and doing different things. He ain't complain, and he wasn't out protesting. And this, he put instilled a sense of purpose and drive into his sons. Now, because of that name, will everybody who has a name be named after or have buildings named after them down the road? No. But the ability to have your name mean something is important. And think about it. Names are important. You think about the people that grew up in your era or that in the neighborhoods that you grew up in. I think of the men that look like me up the street. Elmo Hodges got up in the morning and got garbage. Saved his money and got garbage contracts and trucks. He's not a basketball player, but he's a man with a name. Abram Duff, delivery man. He's his own delivery routes. And gets, saves his pennies and builds his own little business, warehousing. That's a man. Larry Hastings, still up the street. Started out when he got out the Marines, he went off for the plow. Mr. Plow, I'd like to have a job here. By the time he died, he's the plant manager. That's a man. Kevin Massey on the corner. Watch him get up in the morning, go to TVA. Day in, day out, and I see him come home at 3 in the afternoon, change his clothes, go out to Memphis State, 4 or 5 years, he got a law degree. First lawyer I ever knew in my life, personally. That's a man. And you have names that will ring out from this point forward. So you can't sit up today and play a game with somebody off of somebody who is sitting here changing and playing games with his name. Yeah, I know how to change out cell phone chips. I knew how to make myself look like somebody else. I knew how to. And you look at the ping records of that Merwill Hampton. You see that it's not like what Mr. Evans said. It's pinging in Batesville, then pings in Memphis simultaneously. That's somebody that's going to lay out and kill a man that had a name, but replace it with a person who has another name. You know, they ask questions about, can you serve on this jury? Yeah, you can serve on a jury, and it's important to serve on a jury because you are not the family of Mr. Wright. I could never ask or think or expect Mr. Wright's mama to give Billy Ray Turner a fair trial. Why? Because that's her son. No matter what the state has, proof beyond a reasonable doubt ain't as important with her. It won't be, because he's associated with this mess. It's on you all, the 12 of you all, to apply your common sense. Can he have been duped out of the use of his car? And you listen to Claudia's words. When asked by me, y'all making fun of the fact how nice he is, etc. Yeah. You will see the photos that have been introduced into evidence of Mr. Turner on that night. And you all think to yourselves and weigh it. And at the end of the day, you'll see it's not beyond a reasonable doubt that that man can do what they're trying to say that he did. In a few minutes, there'll be rebuttal about knocking down all the stuff that I'm saying. I'm sure it'll either be by Mr. Hackman or maybe by Mr. Schofield again. In a few minutes after that, y'all will be back there and we'll have an opportunity to listen and to argue and to go back and forth with each other. And I want you to understand that today is important for more reasons than you could ever imagine. And people say, well, why do we have this hard standard? Why shouldn't it be a lower standard? Because back in the 1780s, when they were trying to design a constitution, they found that it should be important. So George Mason and another little Jimmy that would end up actually going on to be a president, little Jimmy Madison, said it's important to have a Bill of Rights. Proof beyond a reasonable doubt is a cornerstone of our country. It's a cornerstone that people have died about. People have died from the Revolutionary War, to War of 1812 to the Mexican-American War, to the Civil War, from Civil War to the Spanish-American War, to World War I, and World War II, Korea, Vietnam, Desert Storm. When our nation was attacked on 9/11, it was about our principles. It was about the reasons that we were going to end up fighting for another to eradicate terrorism. And you got people right now standing on the verge of war. You got other nations that look at what we have, and people all the time say, oh, we ain't this, we ain't that. Hell, we ain't perfect, but we are close to it, because no matter what our disagreements on the street might be, that you're able to sit in judgment, colorblind, facts blind, except for the evidence that comes from right there. You all have sworn that you have the ability to do that. And I'm just asking that you do it. No matter what you might like or dislike about each other, that you give in. And at the end of the day, if you're thinking that they failed to reach their burden of proof, you can't compromise that. And it doesn't mean that you compromise. You say, well, okay, well, y'all, if we don't have murder, then let's go all the way down the list and say he must have been an accomplice because he loaned his car. To be an accomplice because he loaned the car, you got to know what they're going to do in it. You have to know exactly what they're going to do in it. Oh, well, we'll come down here and go to a conspiracy, which is the hope. I don't think anybody here thinks that somebody's telling you that, well, he told me that he was going to do X, Y, Z, could get you there. But Jimmy didn't even say that. Jimmy came up with a story about actually going to Atlanta, doing this stuff, and he tells you he has a partner that's texting Cheryl that has never been charged with anything. Why? Because that's the partner that went into the place in Atlanta. And keep in mind this, Jimmy says he gets to Atlanta because Billy appears at his house and says, come with me to Alabama to do a lawn job. No lawnmower, no backhoe, no turnaround, no sickle, no rake, no brooms, nothing. Let's ride to Alabama. And he said, okay, that's cool. Let's go do it. No conversation, no nothing to show you all that he was in fact in that car with him going to kill Lorenzen Wright. And he's going to dump this mess in your chip. It's wrong. But you all have the ability to right it simply by going down 18 times. Not guilty. 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 This is your right to do. Not your neighbor back there. Because your neighbor's ability to change your mind can't happen. Not here. This is too important. Not guilty. Not they failed to reach their burden. I don't care. Not guilty. Not guilty. We ain't talking about not guilty. What we're supposed to come. I'm not compromising the damn thing. Not guilty. Strike it. Write it down. And you keep on going. You be the strength that you need. You be the strength in that room. You be that beacon of light to put an end to this foolishness. No deals. How many of y'all in this commercial? Don't raise your hand. Don't. No deals. No deals. If you hear the gun crime in Shelby County, no deals. Who did deals? Who did deals? Who did deals with Jimmy Martin? Who did deals with Claudia Robbins? Who did deals in this case? Shelby County, Memphis Police Department. Who said no deals? Billy Ray Turner. Suffer me another few minutes. Remember, 2 years ago, back in 19, Christmas Eve, maybe the day before Christmas Eve, sound guilty for a while. And as we talked about the case, we thought we were getting ready to trial back then. Sometimes we talk about music, sometimes we talk about jazz, sometimes we talk about gospel, whatever it might be. And we're arguing here and there about who's, is Count of Blue a good album, this, that, and other. We argue back and forth. So, that's what we were able to do is just talk about a gospel song. Neither one of us are singers at all. But it's a song that I like. It's about LaShawn Pace Rhodes, and it's about I Promised the Lord. I like it because she tells a story about a football player waiting on his daddy. I used to have to do that. And basically, three scenarios. And on the first scenario, while he's waiting on his daddy, daddy told him, don't you get in nobody's car, have his friends come by. Come on, I'll take you home. No, I gotta wait on my dad. That's me. then another come back with some girls. Hey, come with us, go for it. No, I gotta wait on my dad. And then a stranger came. But when the stranger was there, it was raining. It was raining. It was raining. It's easy to wait on your daddy when it ain't raining. It's easy to say, no, I want to give my situation to 12 strangers in Shelby County. Let them be my daddy on this. It's easy to wait if it ain't raining. But when it's raining, and court days because of COVID might get postponed, it ain't easy no more to not want to. It ain't easy to say, I want you all to listen to what's going on and to measure Jimmy Martin and to see if Jimmy Martin is who I believe that he is, a stone cold sitting on the back of Catalyst Creek killer that's changed and put my name in that place and take my chances with them. It's raining. It's raining. It's raining. Review it like you're going to give him that ride. Review it to give him that ride home. Because if they're not beyond a reasonable doubt, based off of the witnesses they have, y'all can't presuppose and help them out and feel bad or feel sorry for Mr. Schofield or feel sorry for whoever's going to stand up or Mr. Hagerman. You can't do that. It's too important. And if he's not guilty to you, you hang on, hold on, and fight it out. Because from the case and from the evidence, he's absolutely not guilty. Thank you, Honor.
It's very it was about 12:40, 1:42, and Deputy Smith tells me that your lunch is here. If you want, we can stop and take a lunch break, and you'll hear the state's rebuttal after the lunch break. I will leave it up to you also. If you need a break before Ms. Hagerman and Schofield presents a rebuttal argument, we'll take a break before that argument starts. Not a fair question, but I believe it totally up to you. If you can, take a moment. Retire to the jury room amongst yourselves. Let me know whether you want to hear a close rebuttal argument now or whether you want to eat lunch first, and we'll do whatever you ask me to do. You can follow Deputy Smith for a moment. Thank you all. Still cannot discuss the case amongst yourselves or with anyone else until all the arguments have been presented. Out. We'll take a recess for a few minutes, get an answer from the jury. You can leave everyone in the courtroom because they might have a quick answer. They want to have to take everybody out and put them back in. Called according to recess, please cut all. please, sir.
Resume recording and audio devices. Yes, sir. I'm sorry. Deb Phillips.
Yes, sir.
I said I'm told you for 1 second. Deb Smith, hold for 1 second, please.
Thomas, my apologies. It would not start without you. Thank you for reminding us, Perry.
Thank you.
Call the quarterback.
We'll come to order.
If you can bring up the jury, please, sir.
Yes, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, everyone can be seated. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, what is the will of the jury at this time?
Move forward.
Ms. Hagerman, you may proceed with the rebuttal arguments.
Just heard, started with Proverbs, talked about 9/11 a little bit, 1780. And we ended with some sort of psalm. That's what we just heard. It's time to do some work. Work. My grandfather worked on the railroad for 48 years. He retired before from that job. He retired from that job before he reached the 50th year because they were starting to use computers and stuff. He didn't want to do that. So after he retired from the railroad, he got another job, and that was as a yard man. That's what he did for the last almost 20 years. And he didn't teach me the value of hard work. He taught my dad the value of hard work, and my dad taught it to me. Now, we, together, aren't going to talk about Proverbs 1780, 9/11, or some song. We're going to get down to the business of work. And we're going to talk about this case. This case. And when I say this, I'm mean the facts that we actually heard testified to in front of us. What I just listened to, Jimmy knows about tracking devices. That wasn't testified to. Jimmy knows about license plate readers hanging out in neighborhoods. That wasn't testified to. That they went to Atlanta in July to kill Lorenzen Wright. No, no. No one's ever said that. That's not the point. They went to Atlanta in June to kill Lorenzen Wright. How many things did we just listen to that weren't testified about at all? Claudia at the funeral took kids to the bath. What are we talking about? What are we talking about? The media asking him a question, but what? We have sat here for 7, 8, I don't know how many days, and we've listened to witnesses who have testified about facts, and now it's our job to do hard work and actually talk about those facts we heard testified to and not stuff we did. And not stuff we did. Two things, two ways, I think, that can help looking at this case. And remember, you're the judges in this case, and what you're asked to bring into this courtroom is common sense. And there's two common sense ways we can look at this case. First, let's look at comparatively. Comparatively. And as we do this, we're going to work and we're going to clear up some of the misstatements, some of the things that aren't even true. Then I'm going to give you a second common sense way to look at this case. And then we're going to talk about some details. The devil's in the details. And we're going to see it. Comparatively. When you start a conspiracy with somebody like we did during Vordaer, you better hope. You better hope that one of the co-conspirators doesn't one day get caught and just tell it. Because if your co-conspirator gets caught and just tells it, it's over. It's over. And we have a co-conspirator, Jimmy Martin, who sat in that chair and who has been interviewed by law enforcement over 20 times since 2012 and who every time has just told it. Three things about his testimony. Three things, all C's. Consistency, corroboration, and then Mr. Perry's word. I'm okay using Mr. Perry's word, contract. Contract. Mr. Perry told you that the state in 2012 entered into a contract, so I just listened to, with Mr. Martin, which says he can never be prosecuted. We're going to look at the contract. We have work to do. Mr. Perry says the contract allows Mr. Martin, or tells Mr. Martin he just has to testify, and then he can never be prosecuted. This is an exhibit, this contract. Mr. Perry's a lawyer. I'm a lawyer, and anybody can understand this contract. Anybody can. Because we can just read it. As a condition of this agreement, contract, Jimmy Martin will at all times tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth during these interviews. Doesn't even cover his testimony, but the truth, the whole truth, but the truth. And if he doesn't tell the truth, What does the contract say? That this agreement not to use his statements against him, not to use his testimony against him, not to use his confession to being involved in a conspiracy to kill Lorenzen Wright, to going on a trip to Atlanta to kill him, all of that becomes admissible and he can be prosecuted to the fullest extent of the law. Well, that's not what Mr. Perry told you it was. He said he had a contract to lie. He said this document gives him a reason to lie, but in fact, this document gives him every reason in the world to tell the truth, or else his life hangs in the balance. The jury instructions tell you, consider a witness's motives for telling the truth. By this contract, actually has all the reasons in the world to tell the truth, or else he gets prosecuted. First thing. Consistency. Jimmy Martin has been interviewed over 20 times over the course of the last 10 years. There's a little game attorneys play here at 201 Poplar if somebody's given multiple statements. If everything and every single statement, every single detail is the same, the attorney says it's rehearsed and it's got to be a lie. If there are details that are slightly different, then the attorney says there are details that are slightly different, it has to be a lie. The truth is, on 20 different occasions, by 20 different people, he's been asked 20 different questions in 20 different ways, in 20 different contexts, and every single time he says, me, Jimmy Martin, Cheryl Wright, and Billy Turner conspired with each other to kill Lorenzen Wright. And every time he says, me, Billy Turner, go to Atlanta to kill Lorenzen Wright. Every time. Every time describes the interior of the apartment. Every time talks about Billy's car. Every time says, after that, I'm supposed to be there. The 18th of July is going to be the day. You see it in Cher's text. She knows he's coming in town. The baby shower. The 18th is going to be the day I'm supposed to be there, but I'm not. I'm in Batesville, and I'm calling Billy. Every time. And they do it without me. And I know it because they show up at my house. Metal detector. Cut the barbed wire fence. Look for the gun. Go to the lake with Billy and throw the gun away. Shotgun shells, wire clippers, everything. It's all the same. And it's been the same literally for 10 years. Through 20 interviews.
Objection, Your Honor. This mischaracterization.
20 interviews.
That's a proper argument to your arguments. You may proceed, Mr. Okay. I'm sorry, Ms. Perry. Did you say something?
I didn't say a word.
I told you about that attitude. You would not, under your breath, be disrespectful to this court, sir. You argued things he has a right to ask for, not to overrule your argument to what you said down. So, of course, it is. It is a
proper. I didn't say, of course.
Ms. Perry, it's a proper argument to your argument. You may proceed, Ms. Ashford.
Yes, sir.
10 years, 20 different interviewers, the same story over and over and over. You want to pick out a detail? One time, he said they cut the barbed wire fence out there in Cal's Cut Off. One time he said, well, I'm on the other side of the street looking for the gun when they cut the barbed wire fence on Cal's Cut Off. Is that the detail? Is that the detail we're supposed to use to throw out Jimmy Martin's testimony? That's absurd. That's insane. every time for 10 years, it's been the same. Consistency. Corroboration. Do you know what's not supposed to ever be found? I mean, ever. 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 How on earth? How on earth is this gun ever supposed to be found? You want to talk about corroboration? Is Jimmy telling the truth? Well, in 2012, he said there's a little lake. I'll draw you some crude little map. I'll walk you where Billy stood when he threw it, and I'll show you the area. And what do you know? What do you know? Never supposed to be found. Corroboration. I don't know her name. I don't know why she's there. But there's a pregnant woman who's in the house when we're meeting, talking about killing Lorenz and Wright. Well, what do you know? Years later, the police find the pregnant woman who was in the house, who heard him talking about killing Lorenzen Wright. Cooperation. During this time, back and forth, I've got Billy's car. Now, Billy has a truck too, but during this time, back and forth, I've got Billy's car, a Dodge Stratus. Where'd they find that car? Hidden in the woods for years behind Billy's cousin's house, who sees the news and then he needs to get rid of it. Corroboration. For years, I'm in Batesville when they do this. I'm supposed to be there. I'm trying to get in touch with Billy. I'm supposed to be there. I'm supposed to be in Memphis doing it, but I'm not. Well, Ceasefire, or Verizon, or whoever it is, they're not in cahoots with Jimmy Martin. What do you know? But his phone's in Batesville, North Batesville, trying to get in touch with who? Just like he said, Billy Turner. So when you think about Jimmy, think about those three C's. A contract that says you've got to tell the truth or else you get prosecuted. The consistency through the years and years and years with investigators and investigators and investigators. And the corroboration. If a co-conspirator tells it, it's done for all of us. There was more than that. You heard about Claudia. You heard from Claudia Robinson, school teacher. You saw the car pulled out of the woods. You saw the secret meeting set up in code after the release of the gun is found. You heard about Shara's text. You even read them, a code with Jimmy about the murder. You saw the text to Billy right before the murder. You saw the phone proof where Billy is not at his house, but instead his phone is on the move after midnight. And at 12:14, in the same area covered by Lorenzen Wright's 911 call. You saw Sarah's searches, didn't you? After they found the gun? How long do fingerprints stay on the gun after water? How long do fingerprints stay on the gun underwater? A weapon? A murder weapon? Billy Turner, Billy Turner, Billy Turner, Billy Turner. You saw all of that. And you even heard about his lies. You even heard about his lies. When's the last time you seen Sherry? Randomly ran into a church. That's not true. All right, I'm lying. Why? No answer. to go to Atlanta? Yeah. Could you have been there when Jimmy was there? If I was, coincidence. All right. Why'd you go? Who'd you see? Family. Give me a name. Give me a nickname. Give me an address. Give me anything. No. Couldn't name anybody. Couldn't name anybody. You heard all that on top of each other. Jimmy corroborated, consistent with a contract to tell the truth or else he goes to jail. Claudia Robinson, a car pulled out of the woods, phone records putting Billy in the area of the homicide at the time, suspicious texts, coded messages, secret meetings, share a search history, everything else. You heard all this, and on the other side you heard, I talked about comparative as the first way to look at this, comparative. On the other side you heard that Billy was at a party until 10 o'clock. We're supposed to check our common sense at the door. Now we got you in here with common sense. On one side we hear, and on the other, Billy's at a party until about 2 hours before the homicide. That's the defense. I mean, think about it like this. I told you another way to look at it, common sense. Either or. Either or. Either Billy's guilty or what's the alternative? What's the alternative? Because we know she and we know Jimmy's guilty. He's told us as much. Involved in the conspiracy. So if they're guilty, either Billy's guilty or what? Or he was framed. Or he's framed. That's the only thing that makes sense. I mean, it's not like he's misidentified. I mean, I guess that'd be a possibility. Well, they're talking about the wrong person. They don't really mean this Billy. They mean like they got him confused with somebody else. No. They obviously didn't confuse, so he wasn't misidentified. Maybe it was an accident. Like Billy accidentally got involved? Like he accidentally drove to Atlanta with Jimmy to kill Lorenzen Wright? Or he accidentally got that text in the middle of the night and went to the area where the murder was? Or he accidentally threw the gun in the lake? No. I mean, some crimes could be committed accidentally, but not this. So it's not mistaken identity. It's not an accident. He would have to be being framed. All right, Billy would have to be being framed. That's the only other possible alternative. Either or. If Shara's guilty and Jimmy's guilty, either Billy's guilty or he has to be being framed. I told you about my grandfather being a yard man, so I don't mean this in any other way, but I mean, is this something we've seen before? Is this something we've heard about before? People framing the yard man? I mean, is that a thing? Is that a thing that happens in life? People framing the yard man? Like, why on earth? Like, Claudia Robinson's the nanny, and she just hates the yard man. I mean, she hates the way he cuts. I don't know what it is. She hates him, so she decides she's going to lie and say that Billy was at these meetings about talking about Cher Wright, so she decides she's going to frame him. But not just that, Jimmy. Some reason Jimmy hates Billy, even though you ask Jimmy about Billy, and he's like, we were both hoping Lorenzen wasn't in Atlanta when we got there. It was the consensus, was his words. But Jimmy must hate Billy. Sergeant Evans looking at the phone records, he must hate Billy. Or maybe it's ceasefire. Maybe it's the phone company hates Billy and is going to make his phone look like it's over the murder scene. Billy's cousin with the car hidden out in the woods? Shara? She's got to be involved in the frame job too, because once the gun's released, she's got to, you know, how long fingerprints stay on a murder weapon? Billy Turner, Billy Turner, Billy Turner, Billy Turner. She's got to have a secret meeting with him. I mean, think about the craziness you've got to come up with
in your head for the alternative to Billy Turner being guilty? He has got to be framed, and all these witnesses have to be in. They've got to frame the yard man. Frame the yard man. That's nonsense. That's nonsense. I told you the third thing. This is a little work here because it's the devil's in the details, and the devil can be in a few of these details, and I find them interesting. The night of the murder. Cheryl Wright to Billy Turner. The last text she sends. We are 13 plus 12, 25 minutes away from Lorenzo Wright being killed. Mr. Perry suggested that this is an innocent text. We don't check our common sense at the door. It can't be an innocent text. Let me read it. I'm going to need my commission. Wren wants you to bring your cards in the AM before he fly out. You owe me, boy. Why can't it be an innocent text? Because Cheryl Wright, the person that wrote the text and sent the text, knows what's about to happen. She's about to kill Lorenzo Wright. Do you understand that? Like we started this whole thing with Cheryl Wright's guilt. That's established. Everybody knows that. Jimmy Martin's guilt of being involved in the conspiracy. So somebody that's about to kill their husband is sending Billy a text saying their husband's going to do something in the morning? Uh-uh. That's impossible. That doesn't make any sense. That doesn't make any sense at all. It can't be an innocent text because Lorenzo's going to be dead by the morning. So you're not going to be texting anybody about Lorenzo doing something in the morning. Her code. Jimmy testified, and he did it quickly. He did it when I was standing here looking at him, because I remember it. He said her code with him, with Jimmy, was a party. And he said her code with Billy was long jobs. Long job. Cheryl needed to that her and Lorenzo were leaving the house to go to the location that's been picked out for this murder. 11:47. Get together, drive to the location. So what did she tell Billy? Wren wants you to bring your cards in the AM, business cards, long jobs. It's on. That's the code in that text. The long job is on. If you read some of Cheryl's other coded text to Jimmy, and to Billy. No. read some of Shara's other text in code to Jimmy, and her other text in code to Billy, you'll see that she just can't help herself with a little added language. I mean, there's no sense in going into all the details and coded details that she does in the code, but she just can't help herself. And you'll see that she has a simple thing she does sometimes. When she sets up the third-party meeting from somebody else's phone, Mr. Schofield mentioned she has the little code, or whatever you want to call it, this is your sis from Cabin. And we know it's a code because even Billy's like, doesn't recognize it at the start. But that's not the only code in those simple little texts, and this is interesting. This is in response to Billy, how long are you going to be in town? A couple of days. And then she says, you should eat at TJ's. Anybody think that was weird when they heard it? TJ's? The woman's name, whose house they're meeting at, is Janice Taylor. JT's. Not TJ's. Not TJ's. And you look at her codes with Jimmy, she does the same thing. She just flip-flops stuff. I'm going to need my commission. Lawn job's on. It's time. We're leaving the house. We're going to do this tonight. You owe me, boy. Flip-flop it. I owe you. I owe you. They're on their way to Cal's cutoff, and Billy's there, and he's about to do this thing for her, and she's going to owe him. She's going to own. Devils in the details have seen, as the phone person testified and as other people testified, some of you studying phone records. Let me give you a caveat or a caution here. As Dennis Evans testified to, what we have in front of us are not the raw records. We have, once the records are put in the computer, a form for us. There's a lot of information we don't have. Limited number of records. Some people's only their call history, not their text history. Some people, their data included. Some people a certain time period, others another. Sometimes adjusted for UTC, other times not. The phone records could be a wormhole, but they can also have a detail on them that's important. A detail a call that's only been mentioned. And when we mentioned it, we did it in general terms. Look at Billy's phone records for the morning after the murder, okay? If he's done this killing with Shara at 12:12 a.m. in the morning, look at his phone records for the next morning. You've heard the testimony about something that's interesting in that. We've described it as a call with Snoop's phone. And we said, that's interesting. That's suspicious. Because at 6:02 in the morning or 6:03 in the morning, why on earth Billy and Snoop? That must be Shara using Snoop's phone's testimony. And that in and of itself is suspicious. I mean, the murder happened at 12:12. Billy and Shara are communicating at 6:02, 6:03, and she's using Snoop's phone. That's suspicious. It's crazy suspicious when you look at it in light of the fact
they don't know. They don't know what information Lorenzen's been able to tell 911. I mean, think about that. Billy chased Lorenzen through the woods and killed him. But he doesn't know if Lorenzen's been able to say who did it or not. They have no idea. So when he's dead, they don't know if the police are going to be knocking on doors. They've got to get apart from each other. They're in scramble mode. They're in scramble mode. They know there's evidence that's left out there, a gun on the side of the road. They don't know what he's told 911. They are in scramble mode. You can't look for a gun left on the side of the road in the middle of the night. You can't look for DNA on barbed wire in the middle of the night, especially if the police are on their way. So we got to get away from the crime scene. We need to get away from each other. We don't know who's coming. We don't know what he told the police on the 911 call. We're in scramble mode. But we know there's work that needs to be done if we get the chance. We know that we got to go find that gun. That's real bad for us. We know that we got to get that DNA off the barbed wire. That's real bad. We need to talk again. We need to meet again in the morning when the sun comes up, if we have the chance, if the police don't come, because we need to go back to that crime scene and clean it up if we can. But we shouldn't be talking to each other on our phones. So how are we going to do it? Crazy suspicious that they're talking on Snoop's phone the next morning, like it's been set up, like they need to talk, like they need to meet, like they need to go clean stuff up and cover stuff up. But crazy suspicious is even more crazy suspicious when you look at the call itself, the devil in the details. Because guess what? It's not Shara using Snoop's phone to call Billy. It's Billy calling Snoop's phone. It's Billy calling Snoop's phone. Well, that right there tells you everything you need to know. The last person she texted before the murder is the first person calling her that morning. There's no missed call. It's not like he calls Cher and she doesn't answer her phone and he's like, I'm going to call Snoop's. Look at the records. He called Snoop's phone to talk to her at 6:02, 6:03 the next morning. His phone records can be a wormhole there. Once in a while, they can be a treasure trove. And right there's a smoking gun. A smoking gun. They had no idea what was going on that night. If the cavalry and the police were on their way, they had to get apart from each other. They had to get away from that crime scene, but they had to get back if they could. And they can't do it by talking to each other on their own phones. Call me on Snoop's phone. That was a mistake. That was a mistake. He called Snoop's phone. He called it. He knew to call it. He knew to keep it secret. How long do fingerprints last on guns underwater? Not long, but how long do guns underwater view and hold their truth and can help solve murders? So whether you look at it comparatively, whether you look at it as either Billy is guilty or this is the craziest frame job in the history of frame jobs, or whether you look at the devil in the details. Billy Turner's guilty of being involved in a conspiracy to kill Lorenzen Wright. It's clear. From Jimmy to Claudia to everything in between, from start to finish. Billy Turner went to Atlanta with Jimmy Moore. Who'd you visit, Billy? Family, friends? Name them. Okay. Because he and Jimmy Martin went to Atlanta to visit Lorenzen Wright. He's guilty of attempted murder. And like you talked about the very first day, when we planned our bank robbery together, criminal responsibility, and conspiracies, and wearing masks and running in banks. 12:12 p.m. on Callis cutoff. We're never going to be able to watch a videotape of it. We're never going to be able to say who fired the first shot. We're never going to be able to say where Lorenzen was hit first. So many things we'll never be able to say, but we'll be able to say that Lorenzen Wright was murdered as part of a conspiracy by Sherrod Wright and by Billy Turner. And you want to throw Jimmy Martin in too? Yeah. He is part of it too. It's not because he's an NBA star. I told you. My grandfather, the yard man. Everybody's life. Lorenzen's, Billy's. Everybody's life matters. Everybody's life matters. And to suggest it doesn't is wrong. Find him guilty as part of this conspiracy. Find him guilty for going to Atlanta to kill Lorenzen. And find him guilty for murder in the first degree for what happened 12:12 a.m. July the 19th. Cal's cut off. 17th, 18th, 19th. They run together. You heard the 911 call. You know how he died. That's murder.